The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Good afternoon. It's Sunday. It's the first Sunday of the month, and it's 12 noon. And what does that mean? It means welcome to PPG World Service, bringing you the best of our industry. So join us, or you have joined us, or you will be joining us on the recorded version to chat, chuckle, and share. And this show today is brought to you by the Pet Professional Accreditation Board. PPAB is operated by the Pet Professional Guild, the international organization for force-free animal training and behavior consultants. You don't have to be a PPG active member to apply to PPAB, but you do, however, have to meet and maintain the strict eligibility criteria. PPAB is independent of any industry school, trade school, college, or credentialing body, and applicants who pass the requirements earn specific titles they can use after their name. So again, this show is brought to you by PPAB. For more information on the Pet Professional Accreditation Board, visit credentialingboard.com. And now I'm going to throw this over to my friend, my colleague, my cohort, my co-sponsor, and over there in Spain. So Louise, hello, how are you?
Hi, Nikki, I'm fine, thank you. How are you?
I am bloody marvelous today, absolutely marvelous. As I was telling you guys earlier, I did drink a cup of caffeine earlier, which is actually not something I do very regularly. So I'm a little jolly.
Well, jolly, good.
A little jolly and a little bit more energy than I usually have, which is always a bad sign because I often am told I have too much energy in the first place. So to top that level off is sometimes not necessarily good. But here we are, and I'm telling you, we have a great lineup today, don't we?
We do, absolutely. We've got Nancy Tucker, we've got Caitlin Quinn, and we've got Maureen Backman, and we've got some absolutely amazing questions to ask them all, and I know that their answers are going to be so interesting for everybody. So yeah, a great lineup,
isn't it? Through this show, I think one of the things that I've realized through doing this show, and I would love to do it every week, and I'm sure we could, we just unfortunately don't have the time because there's so many competing priorities. But when you look at some of the people we have on this show, and I was going, and in particular, I was going through the questions this morning that you'd set up for Maureen, Nancy, and Caitlin, there are so many talented people out there who in their own corner of the pet industry are just doing some really fantastic work. And I think it's just such a great medium to be able to let everybody else know, because apart from the fact that it's very educational, it does make you feel like you're part of a much larger family, which is so supportive. It's just wonderful.
Definitely, and I've got to admit to I'm really, really looking forward to the summit, and not just because of the presentations, but to meet some of these amazing people that we chat to every month. There are so many people, they've got so much knowledge as well. It is amazing.
Well, for me, I'm going to make sure that I stand by the registration desk for the entire time, because I personally, for me, all I want to do at this summit is just get to meet everybody individually. And I'm going to use Maureen as an example and Nancy, because these are two ladies that I have known on Facebook for probably 3 or 4 years. They've been with us right from the start with PPG. And, you know, if they arrived at my front door tomorrow and rang the bell, I'd say, come on in, have a glass of wine, because I feel like I know them already. I mean, you really do. You feel like you know these people so well. So it's going to be so nice to actually be in the same physical location as all these great members and get to know everybody so much better. So it's just a huge, huge, huge support system. And I think for many of us who are out there in our own little areas doing our own thing, I think sometimes, you know, we do get compassion fatigue. And sometimes it's hard to remember that there are thousands of other people that are all standing side by side with us with the same philosophy and the same thoughts and feelings, and are also there whenever we need it, just to say, hey, keep on going. There's a great support system behind you. So yeah, the summit's going to be wonderful. Wonderful.
It is. And actually, that's what makes PPG, the Pet Professional Guild, such an amazing organization, that it brings all these people together. As you know, it's like one massive family. It is. It's amazing. The resources that are out there, the resources that everybody shares with each other. Yeah.
And I don't know if you remember, but a couple of weeks ago on Facebook, I had a particularly bad day. Just one of those days where you sort of feel like you're hitting your head against a wall. And I don't often rant on Facebook. I try and keep everything very professional. And I don't even think it was a rant, but I just made some comment about how I was having a really bad day. And that sometimes you just, you know, you don't really think that you're having an impact. And I got to tell you, I was actually brought to tears by some of the comments and the posts that came back. And it actually caused me to change my entire president message for the November issue of Barks. Because I sat back and thought, oh my goodness, I was going to do a president message purely about the summit and what I was doing in preparation. And I thought, you know what, that's completely changed now, because now my key goal for the summit is just meeting all these fantastic people and saying thank you for being there, thank you for being there for our pets, thank you for being there for one another, because I realized what a huge support system they are. And I think we need to get better at sometimes just standing still and saying to our, you know, fellow colleagues and friends, hey, I need some support. Because when you need it, it's there. It is there in huge quantities. So it is. It's very, very inspiring. So back to what I was saying originally, it's very inspiring that all these people are doing these wonderful things. And it's great that we can talk about them on the show. And it's great that collectively we can all stand side by side and just be a huge support system for each other. So, yeah, it's wonderful. Wonderful, wonderful.
Okay, Nikki. Well, without further ado, I actually think that we better start with our first guest, or else we're going to overrun before we even get going.
Oh dear.
Nothing you see, there.
And we were talking about babbling earlier, weren't we? So we were saying that we have a babble alert. The babble alert is sit down and shut up and let's bring somebody else on to chat. So off you go.
That's it. So what would you like to introduce our first guest?
I sure can. Well, Nancy Tucker. Nancy Tucker, welcome to the show. Nancy is up there in Canada. I know Nancy has so much information and so much to tell us, so I'm going to leave the rest to you guys.
Thank you, Nikki. Hi, Nancy.
Hi, Louise.
Welcome to the show.
Thank you. Really, really happy to be here.
Oh, and we're so pleased that you've agreed to come on and share some of your knowledge with everybody. I'm going to go straight ahead and start with the questions, Nancy.
Sure.
And I'd like to ask you, first of all, about your presentation at the Pet Professional Guilds Force Free Summit, which we were just talking about. And your presentation is entitled The Good Enough Dog, Redefining What a Good Trainer Is. So, just from that title, obviously I don't know anything about your presentation, which you're going to fill us in a little bit, but do you think some trainers expect perhaps a little bit too much of their clients? Maybe they expect too much of their clients' dogs? What do you think?
Well, in a nutshell, yes. I think we might be expecting too much from many of our clients. Not all of them, but many of them. And you know, we talk a lot about setting the dog up for success, and we need to make sure that we're doing the same thing for our client, that we're setting them up for success too. So I actually think that we would do better as trainers and as business owners, because you know, that's what many of us are, really. We're business owners. I think we'd fare better if we scaled it back a little bit with regards to the training plans that we develop for some clients. And that's what it is in a big nutshell. You know, the good enough dog concept kind of came about as a result of the feedback that I was getting from my own clients. I do follow-up phone calls after having met with them for a problem that they may have with their dog's behavior. And I discovered that on many occasions, the client hadn't continued with the plan that we had put together. You know, we call that client compliance, and which I have to inject here, I think is a really, really weird term to use when we're talking about a client. You know, if you look up the definition of compliance, I don't think it really meshes with what we do, especially as force-free trainers. But anyway, I found that they were either simply giving up trying with the plan, and they didn't feel good about that. Either they were embarrassed to tell me that they didn't continue with it, or they were just overwhelmed by it, and the point is they didn't feel good about it. That's when the light bulbs started to go off for me, because sometimes they would stop after only the first or second step in this elaborate plan that we had put together, because they were actually happy with those minimal results. We ended up just putting out the fire for them, and that was good enough for them. And they were more than happy with just that minimal result. So modifying the dog's behavior to the degree that I knew it could be done turned out to be completely unnecessary.
Okay, so what advice would you actually give a trainer then if a client seems, I'm going to sort of say disinterested in the recommendations, perhaps not disinterested, but they, you know, then they're sort of saying to you that they're happy enough, as you said, that the dog's good enough. What advice would you give a trainer in that situation?
That's a great question, and I think disinterested is a pretty good term, actually, because you know, that's where many of us get stuck as trainers. We know what needs to be done. We know how it needs to happen. And getting the client on board with that is sometimes the only obstacle. So, you know, what do you do when it looks like your client's disinterested or unlikely to go ahead with the plan that we've put together? I say act like a first responder. You know, don't get too far ahead of things. Just stay with the very basics, like management, for example, and stop right there. Just at the beginning, just stop right there. Put out the fire. And I use that expression a lot, you know, in terms of restoring the calm. It's like trying to watch TV or maybe listen to some music or have a conversation with somebody while the stove fan is set on high in the background, you know, or you've got some other background noise, I don't know, a chainsaw or something that you're not necessarily conscious of until it stops. And then when it stops, it's that sense of relief that, oh, that's much better. You didn't realize how much something was annoying you until it stops. So going back to my management example, if the person calls you for, you know, say a barking problem, you know, we can create a most elaborate plan to truly modify that dog's behavior under all kinds of circumstances, in all kinds of contexts. But you know, as you describe the plan to your client, and you see that glaze come over their eyes, or they're just, you know, their shoulders slump, and they're like, oh, how long is that going to take? When you see that happening, just stick to the basics. Have them do some basic management, you know, covering the windows, I don't know, curtains, frosted decals, cardboard, whatever, put out the fire, and then maybe tell them, I'll call you later this week and we'll see where we're at. So the example that I was giving before about the feedback I was getting from my clients, often in doing that, you'll find that once the barking has stopped for a few days, you know, that stove fan has been shut off, the client feels better. They're not as irritated. They're in a better state of mind to hear your plan. Or, and this is what I've found to be quite common, the client is actually quite happy with the management solution. You know, they might say, actually, we're okay. You know, the barking has stopped. We're fine with this. We don't need to move forward anymore.
Nancy, I'm going to interject there because I could not agree with you more. And one of the things that we've always taught our dogsmiths is exactly that, is that not every client wants to go through, for whatever reason, whether it's they're too busy or the financial implications, they don't always want to go through a full behavior change program. And more often than not, just reestablishing some relationship criteria and putting in some great management is often enough for our clients. And I think we have to be very open to that.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah, I'd say absolutely the same as well. And if you have a plan and you even think that you're going to go ahead with this plan, I'd also say, you know, don't give it all to the client in one go. It's like, yes, oh my God, you know, all this information, like what on earth?
And you know that I have a whole, as you know, Louise, because you've read my book, I have a whole chapter on that in my book. I mean, we literally waterboard our clients with information, and you see them all just with this awful look on their face thinking, oh my goodness. You know, that's not what they want. They don't want to be waterboarded. They want, you know, in some cases we have to drip feed them or spoon feed them, and often they don't need all that information anyway. So I think it's a really fine skill determining what is enough for your clients. And I think most importantly, the fundamental question for me is to establish mutually agreeable and very achievable goals. And I think sometimes as professionals we forget to do that. We forget to ask our clients exactly, you know, what they would like to see as the outcome.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
That's so true, because the goals of the trainer may well be very different, as Maureen just said, to the goals of the client. You know, the client is just happy that they've got a little bit of peace and quiet, for example.
Yeah.
And yeah, they don't need, you know, this whole sort of whole plan to be put in action. On sort of on the same subject, what advice would you actually give to an owner, Maureen, then, who actually feels overwhelmed by all the information that they've given? So from the owner's perspective, what advice would you give?
Okay, I'm going to assume you're speaking to me, Nancy.
Sorry, Nancy, what am I saying? I do apologize.
Oh, Maureen, you're welcome to jump in, but I'll take this question.
So sorry, Nancy.
It's fine. What advice would I give to an owner who feels overwhelmed? Well, you know, if the client is feeling overwhelmed, then I've done something wrong. I need to scale it back. You know, if a dog appears to be overwhelmed with what we're asking of them, the first thing we do is break it down into smaller chunks. So I don't see why this would be any different for our human clients. Just make sure that they remain below threshold and that they are not feeling overwhelmed, because an overwhelmed client is highly unlikely to follow through with your plan. For sure, you know, like what Nikki was describing earlier is spot on. And it's not, I don't think that it's dumbing down. I don't think that it's treating our clients like idiots or like they you know, they couldn't possibly understand this plan. I don't think that that's the case at all. I think it's a matter of dealing with the client who is in front of you. If I go to meet with a client in the evening, which is the most popular time for most behavior consults in home when people are home, if I show up at the house, it's 7 p.m., I see that they've got school-age kids who are still in their school clothes, the TV's on, their lunch bags are not unpacked, the family's eaten, the dishes are still in the sink, the dog hasn't been walked, homework hasn't been done. I'm meeting with the client, I can tell she's still wearing her work clothes, and it's 7 p.m. I'm thinking, you know, whatever plan I present to this person, given what I'm seeing here, does she even have time to dedicate to what it is that I have in mind? So again, I'm going to focus on putting out the fire. I'm going to focus on her getting some sort of sense of control over the situation, just small bites, small chunks. Once we've got things under control, then we can revisit whether or not she wants to move forward.
You know, I I'm going to interject here, and I think if Rebecca wants to, she can jump in too. But when Rebecca and I first met each other, we both realized that we had pretty academic husbands in terms of where their minds are at. And we would often share a joke and a chuckle about how when you ask them a simple question, they would actually recite an academic paper. And it was Rebecca who came, and Rebecca said to me, she said that, and I do this with Rick now to this day, she said to me, when she asks Robert something, she'll tell him, give me the sentence answer, or she'll say, give me the paragraph answer, or if she has the time and the inclination and wants to learn more, she'll say, give me the academic paper. And I think we have to think about it in those terms, and we're dealing with our clients, that sometimes they just want the sentence. They just want to know, what can I do right in the here and now to stop it? And other times they want the paragraph. They want a little bit of an understanding and comprehension behind the concepts. And then there are other clients that will say, give me the academic paper. They want to hear everything. They want the citations. They want the refer to expert. They want to know where they can go do further research. So I think we have to look at your clients and say, is this client in the here and now? Do they want the sentence, the paragraph, or do they want the academic paper? And I think that's a really good way of sort of breaking it down in terms of how much information we give them and what is really salient to them in that particular moment.
And, you know, the interesting part about that is if you do have the client that just wants the sentence, sometimes if you give them the sentence and you let it sink in and you let them sort of enjoy that quickie solution that you've just given them, sometimes then they become more open to learning more.
Absolutely. And I think that's because, particularly with adults, adult learners need to know very quickly, why is what you are telling me relevant? Because if I can't correlate relevancy very quickly, I'm not interested. And I think sometimes we jump to the academic paper and we leave the client sort of thinking to themselves, well, why is all this relevant? Where is this going? Why do I need to know this? Whereas that one sentence can deliver that relevancy, and then they come back with a hunger for wanting more, rather than being put off because we jump straight into the academic paper. So, and I think that's one of the attending skills that we all need to have. We need to, I mean, you know, as we all know, we're not just dog trainers. We spend most of our time teaching people. So that's really important. So, yeah, I agree with everything you're saying, Nancy. I think you're absolutely spot on. I'm really looking forward to hearing your session.
Oh, wonderful. And, you know, one more point about that is that sometimes, you know, originally when we had talked about whether or not we expect too much of our clients or our clients' dogs, sometimes what we consider a problem might not be a problem for the client. We might be over-solving the problem when really they don't see it as a problem, so we don't need to go there.
Yeah, and you know, there's loads of examples, isn't there? And I remember one, I went into someone's home many years ago. They had a dog that was not house trained, and it was actually a Mastiff. And when I walked into the house, I noticed that they had this beautiful Chesterfield leather sofa and half the arm had been chewed off. And I looked at the client and said, is that general? And she said, well, yes. I said, well, do you want to talk about that as well? She goes, no, we don't care about that. And I remember thinking, you know, I mean, really, they didn't care. So, you know, and the saying is so true, isn't it? It's not a problem unless it's defined by the client as being a problem.
Yes.
We can't just go in there and say, well, this isn't acceptable in terms of my opinion, so therefore I'm going to build into the plan all these other caveats that the client really doesn't care about, not interested. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
Obviously, it's related to safety, you know, if the dog growling and lunging at people is not a problem for the client, it might be a problem.
But we also know that we all come across those clients that don't even see that as a problem.
So I think that in the phrase, if it's not a problem for you, it's not a problem, I think that I would exclude dangerous behaviors and maybe anxious behaviors where we can tell there is a problem here with your dog. But you're absolutely right. I think that unless the client says a certain behavior is a problem or wants help with that, then it's not up to us to define that for them.
Right, or try and squeeze it into the plan in a very sort of discreet manner. Yeah. Oh, well, first, before we address that, we need to put these things in place first. No. Sorry, Louise.
I'll tell you what, I thought
I ran out of your questions.
That's fine. I was going to say, you know what else is also true? Sometimes there are some things, for example, that with my own dogs, I don't consider a problem, but I know that for a pet dog owner, they might be a problem. And so it can actually work the other way as well, that
Absolutely.
They can be really worried about something that, you know, I'd actually think was fine, but it's like, okay, right, well, we can work on this. And so I think you have to really listen sometimes to what the client is saying.
Absolutely,
Yeah.
I mean, how many clients have you had where they've sort of told you midway through the informant interview that, well, I know this is going to be a problem. I know I shouldn't do it when my dog sleeps on the bed. And I go, why is that a problem? I wouldn't expect my dogs to sleep anywhere else but the bed.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, that's an example of where they think we're going to judge them and they think it's wrong and they think it's a problem because they obviously buy into some type of dominance theory. And it's like, no, that's not a problem. It's not a problem unless it becomes a problem in terms of the dog resource guarding or growling or whatever. But, yeah.
I've done consultations where, you know, the basis for the consultation, the reason that they called me, was based on things that they had been told by family members or friends, and, oh, you've got to get that looked at. And it turns out it was nothing. It was, you know, the example that you gave of the dog sleeping on the bed.
Yeah.
You know, maybe they called me because we can't get our dog off the couch. And, well, do you want your dog off the couch? Well, shouldn't he be off the couch? Where there was really no reason for me to be there. It's there isn't a problem after all.
Right, yeah. Yeah, and that's why it's so important to find out what are the client's goals and are they realistic, are they achievable, and then let's agree on where we can go and how we can get there. I mean, it's all just really good stuff.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Anyway, Nancy, I'm going to ask you a question now, and I don't know what your answer is going to be at all because it's one of those questions, but if you had to describe a good trainer, what would your description be?
I love this question.
Oh my goodness, talk about putting somebody on the spot. Yeah. What are going to be like, okay, what's Nancy going to say to this one?
Well, what's really fun is that we're not on Facebook right now, because if we were on Facebook, I would probably write something, then duck.
I'm on Facebook. I I'm going to post it on Facebook.
Okay. Well, another reason I love this question is because the answer lies in who is being asked this question. So if you ask a trainer, you'll get a very elaborate answer based on technical skills above all. You know, there'll be methodology. You know where this could go if we were asking a trainer. Mm-hmm. If you ask a dog owner who has had to hire a trainer for whatever reason, the answer will be based on whether or not they felt it was money well spent. And guess what? That has nothing to do with trainer skills. It has everything to do with how the client feels. Are they happy? Do they feel better about their dog? Because if they do, they'll tell people about it. So even if you're technically the best trainer in the area, technically, if the client isn't happy, your business will suffer. And if the client is happy, your business will thrive. It's just how it works. And again, it brings us back to the bottom line is we are business owners. And unless we have happy clients, we can't keep running our business. We have to be able to draw in the clients. So we need a happy client. So I do believe it's absolutely crucial as trainers that we keep growing, practicing, learning, honing our skills, because we can't always quit on the first step. You know, sometimes we need to really follow through with something and we need to know what we're doing. So I think that although we need to focus on our skills, it's equally important that we learn to listen to our client and to listen to what our clients are not saying. And that's where observation skills are important. You know, the example that I gave of sitting in this client's kitchen at 7 p.m. and looking around me, those are observation skills. You know, I can tell by looking around me what is most likely to happen in the next few weeks with this dog based on whatever plan I give her. So that's my answer, and I'm sticking to it.
It's a fantastic answer. Such a good answer. Love it. Love it.
And it's recorded.
Yes, it is. Be prepared. But I honestly don't think that you could get any negative comeback from that answer because it's such a good answer, Nancy.
Oh, good.
Brilliant. Okay, well, I'm going to ask you one last question, Nancy, and I'm totally going to change the subject. Okay. You did a webinar for the Pet Professional Guild, and it was called the Levels Class Program.
Right.
And it describes the advantages of using this class format, the Levels Class format. Mm-hmm. Can you explain exactly what a Levels Class is, please?
I'll start by saying that the reason that there was a webinar at all is because it takes about an hour to explain what a Levels Class is. In a nutshell,
I guess we're running then.
But in a nutshell, the you know, it's completely explained in detail in the webinar. But in a nutshell, the Levels Class is like an ongoing registration class. It is completely different from what we have come to know as a traditional training course where it might run for 6 weeks and everybody comes once a week or every Tuesday at whatever time and everybody progresses at the same speed, at the same pace, where you can't miss a class because after 6 weeks another session starts. With Levels classes, you're offered the opportunity as a trainer to accommodate a greater number of registrations because of the way that the course is set up. It's a flexible training program, so people can miss class and not miss a thing. They can make up their class. So that's it in a nutshell. It's just it's a way for a trainer to be able to increase their income because you're accommodating a greater number of registrations and you're not turning away potential students because, you know, somebody has called you 2 or 3 weeks into your existing session and you won't be able to start another one for another 5 or 6 weeks. And you tend to find that the clients or the students are more satisfied after completing a levels type program because the dog is trained at the end just because of the way that it's structured. Is that... it's general and vague enough.
Yeah, no, that's great. I did actually, I watched the webinar myself, and it is a great webinar. And I would say to anybody, get onto the Pet Professional Guild's website and have a look at the recorded webinars. It's up there, so you can still actually listen to the webinar, and it is definitely worth listening to.
Wonderful.
So that's the Levels Class Program. By Nancy Tucker. So just go on to the Pet Professional Guild, everybody, and have a look at the recorded webinars, and you'll find the list in there. Thank you so much, Nancy. Can I just ask you before we go, how can people get in touch with you and learn more?
My website is nancytucker.ca. The .ca is for Canada. And my email, which can be found on the website, but I'll give it here in case there are any questions, is woof, W-O-O-F, at nancytucker.ca. And, of course, I'll be at the PPG Summit. I can't wait to meet everyone.
And we look forward to meeting you too, Nancy. Thank you so much for answering our questions.
Thank you.
Thank
Nancy.
You.
Thank you, Nancy.
Bye-bye. Bye. Okay, Nikki, on that note, we chatted quite a bit there about Nancy's presentation at the summit. Could you give me an update on the madness of the preparations that you're doing at the moment for the summit?
Oh, what can I say? Right now we are formalizing and finalizing the summit, the official summit guide, which everybody who's registered will get a copy of that 2 weeks out, I believe it's going out, and that will give you all the information you need about how to get there and the weather and all that kind of fun stuff. We're also putting together a fantastic catalog of all the presenter slides. There'll be two or three slides a page. So again, anyone that is coming there will receive a copy of that a few days out. So if they choose, they can print it, use it for notes. So that's a really nice memento. So we're getting all those back from the speakers right now. We are so busy finalizing all the free gifts and the goodies, which is great. So obviously I'm not going to talk too much about that, but we do have a fantastic PPG t-shirt that was designed by Denise O'Moore from Mighty Dog Graphics. And she worked very hard with Kelly Faye Hay to design that and the summit planning team. So we're really proud of our t-shirt. We think it's going to be a huge success. And I think there's plans to make it available to members after the summit as well to buy, because the design on it is really special. So really excited about that. And just, I'm going to talk a little bit about some of our sponsors so that I can talk about some of the stuff that's going on. But Sixth Day is sponsoring the banquet, the splash dinner, so that means that we're able to upgrade the menu. I know people have paid for that, but it means we can offer a higher level of food and drinks. The Climb, another company that's recently sponsored us, is actually sponsoring a second t-shirt, so that's great. Business Insurers of the Carolinas is sponsoring the actual swag bag. We have a really nice swag bag that all these wonderful free gifts are going to go into. And then Dognostics is also sponsoring something in the bags and the lanyards, the event lanyards. And then Pet Alert is sponsoring one of our coffee breaks. So I wanted to use this opportunity just to say thank you to our sponsors, and thank you so much for the sponsorship contracts they've signed. We're going to do our best over the next 12 months to make sure that they get absolute maximum exposure. We're also finalizing our vendors. It was never designed for us to have a massive exhibitor hall. That was never the plan for the first one, but we did want to have 15 vendors to go in this really nice round river room that connects onto all the rooms and where we're having the lunches and dinners and stuff. So this just gives you an overlook of Positively is sponsoring a vendor booth, and we're hoping that Victoria will also be there. National Canine Research Council, our friends over at Dogwise, and the Clicker Company, and the Pet Professional Accreditation Board, and Wash and Zip, and Pet Shooter. Towser will be there to video it. We're going to have a really nice DVD available afterwards. Dog Tech are coming as well, which is great. And then we're going to have Zooks. Zooks are bringing some really great freebies. So there'll be lots of really good stuff for people. So just a very exciting time, really, really busy. And Dr. Lynn Honickman was on Facebook a couple of days ago asking if anyone was staying over the summit. And if they were staying, would they like to join her at the African Kingdom in Disney? And my comment to that was no, because I will be sleeping for a week afterwards. So it's a lot of fun. It's also a lot of hard work. And again, never can give enough thanks to all the volunteers that have helped too. So yes, it's really exciting. And it's only, 4 weeks away, 5 weeks away. Woohoo!
If that's so exciting, I can't believe all the amazing sponsors and wow, it's everything you say. It just it's I just want my swag bag now.
Well, you know what, when we first started it was so hard getting sponsors, and you know, I have four companies, and I said to the committee, if I need to, I'll just tap into my four companies. They'll have to sponsor something each company, because there's certain things that have to have sponsorships to be able to do this. And it was so difficult because we obviously won't take money or can't take money from a company that doesn't align themselves with our guiding principles. And there are a lot of companies out there that would have been happy to give us money, but we have to stand true to who we are and what we are. So it was difficult. And it's also difficult because it's the first one and it's a risk for people to invest in sponsoring because they don't know that much about us or how successful it's going to be. So all these vendors that are coming and the sponsors, I will do everything in my power for the duration of my term as president of the PPG to make sure that we give a maximum exposure, because they took the risk on us, they've worked with us, they're going to come along and help us help contribute towards a great summit. And I think, you know, the fact that they took the risk and they stepped up, I think that's just massive kudos to them. So big thank you to all of them. And I hope that all of you are at the summit will spend as much time with vendors as possible to really make it worth their while being there. So I don't envisage the same sort of struggles next time. I think next time it will be a lot easier for us to get vendors and sponsors. But there were days on our committee calls and I was just like, oh no, we can't find sponsors. And you know, the team were like, it'll come. And it did, and it has. It's not been easy. And Bob Levinson, who stepped up to help us with sales, did a great job as well. So yeah, it's wonderful. And they're all people we know, people we respect, and companies that align themselves with us. So it's just really nice. It's just going to be a massive, I think it's going to be a really good emotional and mental boost for anyone that's there, because you're going to be surrounded by people that are your peers, that are your cheerleaders, your supporters, and then companies that we can all comfortably do business with because we know that they're all so aligned with us. So it's just really exciting time.
Definitely, and like you said, a great networking opportunity for everybody as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, well, I think we better get on and introduce our next guest. So we've got Caitlin Quinn joining us now, and Caitlin is the Assistant Director of Animal Farm Foundation, a not-for-profit corporation that's been making rescuing and rehoming animals, as well as making grants to other humane organizations since the mid-1980s. Animal Farm Foundation currently dedicates resources to securing equal treatment and opportunity for pit bull dogs. So, Caitlin, are you there?
I am. Thank you for having me.
Welcome, Caitlin.
You're welcome. Thank you so much for coming on the show. First of all, I'm going to drop you straight in there, and I'm going to ask you, because there's a lot of confusion, can you please clarify exactly what's meant by the term pit bull?
Well, that is, I think, the million-dollar question. I think that in some ways it's easier to have that conversation around what isn't a pit bull sometimes, but the stance that Animal Farm Foundation has taken, especially in our work with animal shelters primarily, is that we need to sort of reevaluate that term. Lots of dogs are coming into shelters, and no matter what they look like, are being mislabeled just due to the fact that visual breed identification is really a difficult task and somewhat impossible task for those working in shelters. And so when it comes down to the dogs who are being labeled pit bull, really what we're trying to get at is this idea that we can't be making assumptions about those dogs' behavior based on the label that we're giving them. So I guess our answer to that question would be is that a pit bull sort of becomes a social construct in many ways. So if a dog happens to look, you know, sort of muscular and boxy and short-coated, then it tends to be called a pit bull. And we want to call into question sort of what stigmas get attached to those dogs due to that sort of line of thought.
That is so true. And I'm going to say that if you went back, I don't know, even sort of 15 years, I think a pit bull probably referred to an American pit bull terrier, but that's no longer the case, is it? Like you said, it's it seems to be a term that's just thrown about there for any dog that has these vague, you know, it's sort of slightly wide of the chest and wide of the head, and it's got short hair, and it is more, I can't even say a type of dog. It is just a term that is so loosely thrown around nowadays, isn't it?
Yes, absolutely. And what you say is absolutely correct. If in a perfect world, when we said pit bull, we would be referring to American pit bull terriers, and that would just be sort of the nickname given to those dogs. But it's simply just not the way that the world is working right now. It's not what we're seeing in shelters, and it's not what we're seeing in communities that, we're seeing quite the opposite, where a lot of dogs are being called this without, you know, much in common.
Yeah, that's right. Just changing the conversation slightly and going back to Animal Farm Foundation, what are some of the services and programs that are available through Animal Farm Foundation, and who are they available to?
Sure. So as you said, we've been around since the mid-1980s, and most of our resources are geared towards the educational sort of direction, available to advocates, to community members. And in recent years, we've really focused a lot on getting information to those working in animal shelters. So we have a grant program geared towards animal shelter and rescue, geared primarily towards increasing kennel enrichment and the quality of life for animals in shelters, as well as increasing adoption marketing and eliminating sort of the discriminatory policies that sometimes go along with the misinformation that surrounds pit bull dogs. Additionally, we have a couple of really interesting programs that are geared specifically towards changing minds. One of those is an assistance dog training program. So we take dogs who are from shelters, and they go into our assistance dog training program and are matched with a client who, depending on their disability, the dog will perform a different task. And we also have underwritten programs like detection dog programs, and that's sort of to show that these dogs that are being labeled pit bulls are really just representative of all dogs. So some of them are going to be very good at working a specific set of skills, but for the most part, those that are in shelters just want to live on someone's couch, like the rest of the dogs that are in shelters.
And I think that I actually sums it up, doesn't it? Like, what is a pit bull? A pit bull is a dog. It's a dog. Mm-hmm. It's an individual, and they've all got their individual likes and dislikes and their individual, let's say, things that they're better at and things they're not quite so good at. And you have summed it up. But what great programs you've got through the Animal Farm Foundation. Fantastic programs there. We actually recently had the pleasure of chatting to Janice Bradley, the Director of Communications and Publications for the National Canine Research Council. I seem to think that there's a relationship there. Can you tell me, what is the relationship between Animal Farm Foundation and the National Canine Research Council?
Sure, and I'm so glad you got to chat with Janice, and I know that she's going to be presenting at the summit, and she's just wonderful. So NCRC, National Canine Research Council, is a subsidiary of Animal Farm Foundation. And what that means in the practical sense is that a lot of the research and the information that National Canine Research Council does and collects goes into some of the advocacy work that we do through Animal Farm Foundation. So we take that foundation of data and really fact-based information and try to make it accessible for shelters and for advocates and community members through the arm of Animal Farm Foundation.
Okay, right. I didn't actually realize it was a subsidiary. Okay, how interesting. And how cool that you're using actual data. Like, everything that you're doing is backed up with research. you know, it's just, that's how it should be, because some of the policies and the laws that are put out there, you know, they're founded on myth, not on research.
Yes, so, exactly.
Yeah.
It's a very frustrating topic.
It is, isn't it?
Yeah.
I was just going to say, for anybody that's listening, if they want to listen into Janice's interview, there's actually a link to the recording of the August 2nd show. That's the show that she was on August 2nd. And it's in the podcast drop-down menu of the PPG radio page on the Pet Professional Guild website. So that's just because I was referring to that interview. If anybody would like to listen to it, it's a great interview. So that's where you can find it. But yeah, Nikki, it is such a frustrating topic.
But you know, isn't Janice the executive director now? Didn't she recently get promoted?
I think she is, isn't she? Yeah.
And well deserved. And I can't think, and I don't know Janice very well at all. I'm actually really looking forward to meeting her at the summit. I remember reading her book many years ago. I can't think of a better person to head up that organization because she's so articulate and so level-headed and so sort of data-driven that she just really is the ideal person for that job. I mean, I can't think of anybody else in our industry that has the level of experience and expertise that she has that could do a better job, just given her personality and, you know, what she obviously feels very passionate about. So I think it's great.
That's right. And I think isn't she doing three presentations at the summit, Nikki?
She is, absolutely. Yeah, she is. And they're all going to be fantastic presentations.
I was going to say, like, I'm going to be at each one because it's a subject very close to my heart, and I'm going to be listening to each of her presentations. But maybe, Caitlin, can you confirm to us what actually is Janice's position? Is she the executive director now?
I believe she's right under the executive director, so she's the director of research, which really for an organization like National Canine Research Council is probably the most important position within that organization, because as you said, she's really the driving force behind a lot of the presentation of the information that National Canine Research Council comes across, and this idea behind being very data-driven and also finding a way to articulate some of that, because as we know, sometimes data can be really not attainable for the average advocate, the average, you know, community member. Some of that is a little bit difficult to understand, and so I think with Janice's expertise, it becomes very attainable for most folks to understand it.
And I think as well, you know, I mean, I spent 4 years in a job that was working with statistics and data for a huge American company, and you know, we all know that with any statistics and data, unless you can actually dig right down to the research methods and the applicability, what you're given is not always necessarily a representation of the population. And I think the one thing about the National Canine Research Council is they have a lot of integrity and they have a really good reputation. So I think most people feel really comfortable and confident that when they bring out this research, that it is very solid and that it's being represented properly.
Yes, absolutely. And in the internal process for just in terms of the research that National Canine Research Council will be associated with and will use is very exhaustive. You know, there's, as you said, there's a lot of quote-unquote research that really, when you dig down, is sometimes not really done correctly, or the methodology is flawed, or there, you know, some of it starts from the wrong perspective, and so then anything, you know, right, going out from that, right, becomes inaccurate.
Right, or simply the hypothesis that the research was testing, you know, whatever came back from the results wasn't what the researchers wanted, therefore there's a manipulation in how that information is then presented, which, yes, is obviously not good. So yeah, I mean, I remember 10 years ago, before I was even really that involved in the dog industry, well, I was involved but not anywhere near the level I am now, I came across the National Canine Research Council. We actually use a lot of their figures and data to help ban dogs from being chained out 24 hours a day in Florida, in some areas of Florida. So I was exposed to them many years ago and just really felt really good about what they were doing. So just huge kudos to them. They're a great organization.
I agree.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. And Animal Farm Foundations works tirelessly, absolutely tirelessly, to educate, as you said, and to inform both legislators. A lot of the time it's in an effort to end discriminatory policies. Now, I'm personally affected oh, or should I say, well, yeah, I am,
yeah,
my dog
you are.
Is affected,
yeah, absolutely,
by breed specific legislation. And there are some people that still don't know exactly what breed specific legislation is all about. Can you tell us a little bit about it, please?
Sure. So breed-specific legislation is sort of the catch-all term for laws and ordinances in different municipalities, and that can go from the very local level to county level or state level. And they typically, those kinds of laws will put in place some sort of restriction on the ownership or the maintenance of certain kinds of dogs. And so pit bull dogs are typically caught up in this cycle alongside a lot of other breeds of dogs or supposed breeds of dogs. And when you get into the really nitty-gritty of some of these laws, you can really see the flaw in even how they're categorizing dogs. But that includes areas where ownership of certain kinds of dogs is completely, you know, wholesale banned. In other areas, it comes down to restrictive ownership. So you can own a certain kind of dog, but you have to muzzle them in public, or you have to keep them in a certain kind of containment system, you know, sometimes with concrete, you know, 6 inches of concrete and fencing that is 8 feet high and things like that. And it also includes issues of mandatory spay-neuter. So that's something that we see in the U.S. sometimes, is that they'll put into place a mandatory spay-neuter law specifically surrounding pit bull dogs for a county or a municipality. And that is also a form of breed-specific legislation. And in turn, those kinds of legally defined discriminatory policies have a large effect on what happens to shelters and organizations that are operating within those municipalities, and also, you know, trainers and dog professionals.
Yeah. So what you're basically saying is sometimes it can be laws that just put restrictions on owners, and sometimes it can almost be an outright ban on that breed of dog.
Correct.
Yeah, that's the case over in Europe too. For example, in the UK, there is a ban on pit bulls. And there have been quite a few cases where pit bulls have been euthanized for no other reason. Well, a dog has been euthanized for no other reason than somebody's got a tape measure out and they've measured it and the measurements stack up and it happens to have short hair. They class it as a pit bull, and that's that.
Yeah, and the real flaw with those laws is that it leaves no room for this idea of responsible pet ownership or regulating the animals that we have in our community based on the behavior of the dog. So you are either guilty or innocent of being a pit bull simply because of the way that you look, and not including any sort of measurement for dangerous dog issues and things that really do come down to, has a dog actually caused harm or chaos in its community? It's simply about the way that the dog looks.
That's right. It's so sad. They take absolutely no account whatsoever of the way the dog acts.
Yeah.
None whatsoever. The dog is categorized. My own dog, we actually live in Spain, and there's no outright ban. I've got a Staffordshire Bull Terrier, and he comes under breed-specific legislation. And so just because he was born, he is subject to the legislation. I have to have a dangerous dog handler's license. He has a dangerous dog. He's classified as a dangerous dog, which is, in my mind, absolutely, it's crazy. So from the minute he's born, he's classified as a dangerous dog.
That's
crazy. This little puppy is a dangerous dog, and we live with a lot of rules and regulations. He has to be muzzled in public, he has to be kept on lead at all times, at home he has to be behind 2 meter high walls. If anybody comes to our home, he has to be put away inside. He has to have a veterinary check every year to make sure that he doesn't have any diseases or anything wrong with him that could make him especially dangerous. And what is so frustrating is that it doesn't matter how well behaved he is, how well trained he is, that doesn't figure They don't test for that. There's no test for that. It's all down to the way he looks.
And I think what's ultimately the even that's heartbreaking. And I think what's even more irresponsible about breed-specific legislation on the part of the communities that do enact it is that think about all the resources that are being sucked into this regulation of your dog who has never done anything and doesn't show any sort of behaviors that would classify him as a dangerous dog, while typically in a lot of communities, the actual enforcement of dangerous dog laws and responsible pet ownership laws sort of fall by the wayside because now all of these resources are being poured into regulation that isn't actually helping to keep the community safe.
That's so true, and that actually brings me on to my next question. Research that's been conducted and researched by the National Canine Research Council and various experts, it's concluded that breed-specific legislation, it's ineffective in reducing dog bites. It doesn't enhance public safety in any way, and like you said, it costs an awful lot of money. Why do you believe legislators continue to enforce these policies in place of, you know, breed-neutral laws, responsible pet ownership laws?
I think that unfortunately a lot of this comes down to fear and misinformation. So there's the cycle of misinformation that unfortunately I think in our current state of technology, which in many ways is so wonderful, but also allows the perpetuation of misinformation. So we have all of this data and information at our fingertips, and people rely very heavily on what they can find in a Google search. And so in many ways that makes our jobs as advocates a bit easier because it's easier to spread good information. But at the same time, you're constantly battling a cycle of misinformation that is very dangerous and I think feeds ultimately a fear of not the actual dogs, but of this sort of mythological creature that we've sort of turned the idea of pit bull dogs into. And so I think that once someone has been sort of a victim of that fear, it becomes harder and harder to present them with logical information and fact-based information without that little fearful voice sort of nagging at them and sort of calling into question all of the very legitimate information that exists suggests that there is no risk. But I think, unfortunately, fear is a very powerful and dangerous thing, even for our lawmakers and our legislators.
Yeah, that's so true. I could actually chat to you all day. I've got so many questions, but I'm just going to ask you a couple more sort of main questions. I realize that you know, we are running over as usual, but I do want to get a couple more questions in. I've got to mention the majority project. Animal Farm Foundation has been challenging stereotypes by asking owners of, I'm going to say, pit bull type dogs to take action against breed-specific legislation by simply taking their picture. Can you tell us what the project's about? How successful has it been? You know, just give me a little bit of info on the Majority Project, please.
Sure. So the Majority Project grew out of, you know, we've really seen a lot of things improve over a relatively short amount of time for pit bull dogs. And that's not to say that we still don't have these hurdles that we're discussing today to overcome. But as we saw things improving for the dogs themselves and sort of chipping away at some of that misinformation and discrimination, what we did notice is that there was still, especially from the legislative side of things, this idea floating about that somehow the owners of pit bull dogs were different than other owners and different in a way that would categorize them as criminal or sort of other than regular dog owners. And what we wanted to do is really start to tackle that stereotype as well, because what we knew about dogs being adopted from shelters and the dogs that are living in communities is that they're owned by a wide variety of individuals. So what this project proposed to do was to allow folks to sort of speak speak up to that point and take their photo and with a sign that sort of leads with their value. So the signs say, I am a blank, and people fill it in with whatever they want to say. We have, we've had hundreds of people write in that they're moms or that they're families, teachers, nurses, veterinarians, doctors, and then it says, I am a pit bull dog owner and I am the majority. And that idea is to really just drive home that the majority of dog owners, just like the majority of pit bull dog owners, just like the majority of all dog owners, are your average neighbor and not this sort of reckless or criminal element. So that's really where the program and the campaign came about.
A fantastic campaign. I've got to admit that I'm part of the Majority Project a couple of years ago. I took a picture, and it was with my Staffordshire Bull Terrier and my German Shepherd, and it said, I'm a trick dog instructor, I'm a pit bull owner, and I am the majority.
That's so great.
Absolutely fantastic program. How can pit bull dog owners join the Majority Project?
So it's very easy to join the project. You simply visit our website, which is themajorityproject.com. You can print out your sign there and quickly take your picture and just send it back into us. We have a Facebook page, we have a Tumblr blog, and we share those photos as far and wide as we possibly can.
Awesome, and I will reshare my photo later on this evening, so I'll have to dig it out, but I will reshare it. I've got one final question for you, and it's actually from Daniel Antelec, the chair of PPG's advocacy committee, because he sent in a question. He's interested in approaching local government. I thought this was a great question because lots of other people may have this same question. So he's interested in approaching local government. The city council, the village board, and he wants to educate them on breed-specific legislation. He'd appreciate any hard data that he can present to help them make more sensible decisions that affect dogs and dog owners as well. Could you point Daniel and everyone else in the right direction, please?
Absolutely, and I think that is a wonderful question. So I think typically whenever you're going to approach your local government, no matter what that looks like, it's important to do a little bit of background research and find out what their sort of motivating factors are. And for different councils, that will mean different things. In some areas, it's very cost-driven, and so there is some very easily attainable data based on the cost of breed-specific legislation and how much of a waste it is of our resources in our communities. And most of what I'm about to mention is available both through Animal Farm Foundation's website, but also directly on the National Canine Research Council website. I think some of the other hard data that can be very useful is that there's been a number of studies that came out in the last few years that point to this idea that when we are performing, enforcement of breed-specific legislation, that we really have to call into question the dogs that are being caught up in that. So there's a lot of information that's come out on the canine genome and what it means to look at a dog and assume that you even know what it is, let alone, this whole idea that we're really looking at the wrong end of the problem when we look at what a dog looks like rather than how it behaves. And also, in terms of data, there's been some very good information that came out specific to dog bites. And there was a study about a year or two ago now that looked at the few occurrences of dog bite fatalities and looked at the co-occurring factors that occurred in all of those cases. And what they were able to say conclusively is that breed was not a factor in those kinds of cases. So there's a number of studies. I would highly recommend going to nationalcanineresearchcouncil.com to find any of those that I just mentioned.
Thank you so much. And I think that's really important, the last sentence you said, actually. Breed is not a factor. And I think that sort of sums everything up in one way. Breed is not a factor. Thank you so much, Caitlin, for joining us. And can I just ask you, how can people get in contact with you and learn more?
Sure. So the best way to get in contact with me is to email at info@animalfarmfoundation.org. That's I-N-F-O. And also through our website, animalfarmfoundation.org. And all of my contact information is on that website.
Thank you so much. That's been an absolute pleasure talking to you. And I'm going to ask you now, and this applies to all, I guess, but will you please, please come back on the show so that we can ask you lots more questions?
Of course, I'd be happy to. And thank you so much for having me.
Thank you.
Thank you, Caitlin. We must get you back because it's such a broad topic that just needs a lot more time on it. So thank you so much.
That's so true, Nikki. In a way, we haven't really sort of scratched the surface. So, yeah, I think that's a definite must for in the future. And Nikki, would
Hello.
You like to introduce our next guest? Because I think we'll go straight on to our next guest, if that's okay.
Sure. Our next guest is Maureen Backman. And Maureen is the founder of the Muzzle Up Project. So, hello, Maureen.
Hello.
How are you?
I'm doing very well, thank you. And thank you so much for having me on.
You're welcome. Thank you for your patience. We always run over, and even if we said this
It's great because it's a nice segue into muzzles and muzzle stigma after talking about breed-specific legislation and breed stigma.
Sure, we couldn't have planned it any better, really, could we?
Hey, that's what I'm here for, you know, fans. Hi, Maureen. How are you?
I'm good.
Good. I promised to try my best not to call you Nancy, seeing as I was calling Nancy Maureen.
Nancy, so should I unmute? Am I on? Keeping me on my toes.
I will do my best, but if I call you Nancy, then, you know, I do apologize.
It's okay. I know who you're referring to.
Okay, well, Maureen, you're really well known for combining your knowledge of counseling along with your studies in animal learning and behavior. How important do you think it is for people to understand canine communication?
So important. And you know, one of the big things that I tend to find myself babbling on about, speaking of babbling, is this whole idea of having a conversation with the dog, just like we have it when we're really communicating with a person. We're not having a monologue, we're having a conversation. And it's the same with dogs. And even though they can't speak our language, they're still communicating to us whether they feel comfortable or not, whether they're motivated, whether they're into the whole training process that we're trying to do with them. And so the canine communication, whether it be with body language, you know, their responses while you're doing the training session, whether they're frustrated or not, when you notice any fear, it's all a way of taking feedback. And then as a trainer, then we can adjust how we're doing with our training and what we're doing and what the criteria is, and we can have this sort of give and take relationship where it's a conversation, and I feel like it's so exciting to see. This is why I'm so excited to go to the summit, because you know it's so many people now are getting interested in force-free training and this idea of really actually understanding from an evidence-based and science-based perspective what's going on with dogs. And it's just really exciting to see, and it's great to see that more people want to have conversations with their dogs and to actually have training be an enjoyable process instead of this looking at it through this lens of we must get the dog to comply with us, almost kind of using that compliance word like Nancy was talking about earlier, instead of viewing it as, you know, the dog needs to comply with us and do what we want, instead, what choices does the dog have? And is the dog motivated to choose something that's going to be compatible with our lifestyle and what we want the dog to do?
That's so true. Nikki, can I just bring you in, please? Can can you just give a really quick overview of exactly what we mean when we say canine communication? Because I'm aware that we have a lot of pet owners that listen in too. What are we talking about here, Nikki, when we talk about canine communication? Maureen mentioned a few things there, but can you just elaborate a little bit?
Well, I mean, for me, canine communication is, and social behavior, because social behavior is a form of communication, is anything the dog does that in some way communicates a message to us about how it is feeling. And the topography of canine communication is either, you know, distance increasing or distance decreasing. So from a topography perspective, it's how that communication system is either designed to bring people closer or other dogs closer. So, you know, affiliate behavior, social behavior, I want to play, I want to engage, I feel comfortable, I feel happy, or distance increasing, which are the type of signals that we see when a dog is feeling stressed or fearful or anxious. And that could range from a dog that is showing passive appeasement in terms of, you know, please don't hurt me, I'm going to make myself a little mignon, small, 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 to active appeasement where they actually engage with us as a way of indicating cut-off behavior. So for me, canine communication is anything that a dog does that communicates a want or a desire. So no, as Maureen said, they don't speak English, they don't speak French, German, Spanish, or Portuguese either, but they are fundamentally extremely good communicators. I mean, they communicate very, very well. And we have, I believe, as professionals, and not just dog trainers, but I believe anybody that works in the industry, whether you are a dog walker or a pet sitter, has a fundamental obligation to understand canine communication. And I'll take it one step further. We're running a three-day workshop next week for a pet care technician certification program, and 4 hours of that 3 days is allocated to canine communication and social behavior. And that 4 hours actually falls directly after a four-hour session on how pets learn, because learning and communication sort of go hand in hand, don't they? Because we need to be able to understand whether we're creating an environment where a dog feels comfortable, relaxed, happy, and can actually engage and interact with us in a safe manner. So I'm not sure if that's what you're looking for, but for me, canine communication is everything and anything a dog does to indicate its current feeling of empowerment, well-being, or the reverse of that, discomfort. And the topography of that is a myriad of communication skills that are distance increasing, and that they can be very subtle to very, you know, very overt and very covert, to then the topography of distance decreasing, which is when a dog wants to interact and be social. So it's a massive, massive topic. It amazes me that we don't spend more time talking about this. And I think with PPAB, when we look next year at rolling out pet care accreditation programs, that has got to be a huge component of it, because how anyone in our industry can be working with pets that does not have a very good understanding of canine communication just absolutely baffles me. I mean, I'm sitting here shaking my head.
That's so true, Nikki.
Yeah.
It's important, just, you know, just like what Nikki was saying, for anybody who's interacting with the dog. I think it's one of the big challenges and one of the big responsibilities as trainers to help our clients become, in a sense, almost mini trainers, so that they can learn to understand what their dog is trying to tell them, because unless we're planning on being in their homes 24 hours a day, 7 days a week for the rest of the dog's life, which hopefully is not the case, we want the client to be able to continue the work, and if problems arise in the future, be able to respond to them more effectively. And like Nikki was saying, communication is, and understanding what exactly is going on with the dog is at the root of that.
Mm-hmm. And I've always felt very passionate about this, and I think I'm more prepared to talk more to it now since we became the leadership of Dog Gone Safe, because, you know, Dog Gone Safe is what it says it is. I mean, it's all about educating particularly parents and small children how to understand the main indicators that a dog is unhappy and how to behave safely around them. And it's, you know, and I'm not a parent, so I'm not going to judge. I don't like to judge anyway, because, you know, we do as best as we can until we know better. But for me, I find it amazing and baffling as well that people bring dogs into their homes still to this day and yet don't understand. I mean, we see the videos, don't we? We see videos of dogs being teased while they're eating and they're growling and everyone's laughing about it. I mean, and I sort of slap my head against the wall. It's like, oh my goodness. You know, you don't have to be an expert in our communication to know. I mean, we all intrinsically know when a dog is scary, don't we? I think Ian Dunbar mentioned years ago that a good assessment is when you walk in through a shelter and you look through a kennel door and you ask yourself, would I feel comfortable walking into that kennel? And we all know that those dogs wouldn't do that because instinctively we know that something's not quite right. And in many cases, lack of communication can be as bad as communication. You know, I work with dogs that just don't have any communication. They're literally ticking time bombs. So I just think, you know, not just professionals, but I think the pet owning community, and I think as professionals, we have a fundamental obligation to help them to develop some of those skills, like Maureen said, because we're not living with them, we're not in the home, to keep everybody safe, which ultimately keeps the dogs in their homes, you know, being well cared for rather than being relinquished. So yeah, massive topic, huge, huge topic.
Yeah, that's right. And you mentioned a couple of things there, Nikki, that I'm going to pick you up on. You mentioned the Pet Professional Accreditation Board and a certification that's going to be coming up, an accreditation. You also mentioned Dog Gone Safe. So can you just tell us a little bit where, if pet owners, first of all, want to know more about canine communication, where should they go to learn more?
Well, Dog Gone Safe is a journal, and Teresa Lewin, the founders of Dog Gone Safe, did a great job of providing some wonderful resources. I mean, the website is full of resources. There's videos on there. There's pictures, graphical pictures. There's lots of really good information with some of the basic canine communication indicators. Then there's the Be A Tree program, which is a great program. I mean, I don't know why every dog trainer doesn't buy into the Be A Tree program, because as well as being a great educational program, what a fantastic marketing program to bring new clients into your business. Having this great kit where you can go do presentations to children at schools and all kinds of other community events. So just lots and lots of really cool resources there. And we're actually developing another resource that will be aimed at communication to all the children and adults, because right now a lot of Dog Gone Safe is geared towards young school children, which is great. I mean, the program's fantastic, highly interactive, lots of fun, and it basically teaches children some really good fundamental skills about canine communication, how to stay safe. So doggonesafe.com is the website.
Thanks, Nikki. Thank you very much. And for the pet care accreditation, that was the Pet Professional Accreditation Board, I think you said.
It is, and it is in the works. It's been in the works for a while. It'll come some point next year. It was actually an add-on project to our goals, so it's not taking right now. So it's obviously taking the main priority. But you know, it's really important that we believe that, as with dog training and dog behavior consultants, that we have levels of competency. So the Pet Care Technician Accreditation Program will cover anatomy and physiology, health and handling, canine communication, how pets learn, and tools, equipment, and play. So the sort of, and pet first aid. So I think there's six core modules that we believe that every pet care provider should be on top of. And, you know, caring for people's pets is not about just throwing down food and water. It's about making sure that they are mentally, physically safe, that you understand how to communicate with them, that you handle them appropriately in a force-free manner, that you are a pet first aid responder, that you understand health and handling. I mean, there's just so much more. And I think we have an obligation to make sure that we just keep pushing the limits in terms of the level of professionalism within our industry, not just dog trainers, but across the board.
Yeah, definitely. Thanks a lot for that, Nikki. Thank you very much. And Maureen, I apologise for sort of going off on a little bit of a tangent there. Nikki actually mentioned the importance of force-free training, and I know you are strongly committed to force-free training. Can I ask you why? Why are you so strongly committed to using only force-free training methods, Maureen?
Well, I think, you know, part of it is I'm fortunate enough that when I decided to look into becoming a dog trainer, this was, maybe about 4 years ago, so I'm still relatively new to the industry. So force-free training had already taken hold, and so, you know, I went to the Academy for Dog Trainers with Jean, and so it just made sense for me. I was fortunate enough that I came into the industry at a time when force-free training had already kind of stuck to a certain extent, I transitioned to dog training from social work, and my focus was with mental health and dual diagnoses, and the tenets of force-free training really, there's such a strong parallel between that and what the best practices are for working with individuals with mental health diagnoses or with addiction problems. And it's this whole idea of accessing an individual's, or in dog training, a dog's sources of motivation, and really focusing on the science of getting a dog or a person motivated to do a certain behavior, and also understanding that all of the shrapnel, I like to call it shrapnel, but the negative stuff that comes with force, whether it be relief from exposure to something that's scary and using that as a way to motivate a dog to continue doing a behavior, or, you know, if it's inflicting pain or force or intimidation to suppress behavior, it spoke to me because it's not just dogs where that creates problems. It creates problems when working with people as well. It's something that it's for me, it's not just for dogs. It's something that applies to people. So whether it be clients or just random people that you're interacting with in your job, force just is not the most effective way to communicate or to interact with any species. And so it becomes, I don't want to say a way of life because that sounds a bit pompous, but it really does become a philosophy that applies not just to the training situation where you're there with the dog and you're training with your bait bag. It has much bigger implications. And
I don't think there's anything pompous about that, Maureen. I think that is absolutely right. You're spot on with that. I think it does become a way of life.
Yeah. And it's and again, I'm fortunate. I mean, I had a family dog growing up, and we had a prong collar on him, and we didn't. He was a lab, and he was probably at best that marginally trained with obedience, but he kind of, we just let him do whatever he wanted, and he was a great dog. But so we didn't really buy into the corrections or alpha-based training, but we did have a prong because we went to the pet store and we said, hey, we have a 90-pound dog, and we need to walk him, and so they gave us the prong collar, and we just didn't really think about it. And so in that sense, I met, everybody's a crossover trainer at some point, I am very fortunate that I found the academy when I started looking, and I was able just to kind of start from the beginning from a force-free perspective.
What a great answer, and I think something you said there would actually resonate with a lot of people. A lot of people do things without really thinking about them. It's very easy to condemn people for using choke chains and prong collars and even shock collars, and I'm strongly against any of those methods, but I don't think we can just outright condemn people, because sometimes it is just an absolute lack of knowledge. They don't realize the harm that they're doing. So I think the more work that we all do to get the message out there that they are doing harm, that these methods are not acceptable, I think it's really important. But I do think that we need to recognize that, you said you sold a prong collar and it was like, oh, well, that's what you need because it's a big dog.
By a supposed expert in a store, so,
It was interesting because I recently did a presentation on muzzle training for Towser Dog, and a couple of the attendees were actually pet store owners, and it was really fascinating and great to have them there because concluded that they were really kind of the first line of defense for a lot of pet owners on what product they choose, because they'll typically go in and, you know, in the context of muzzles, we were talking about the fact that a lot of times it's that maybe sometimes the first person they speak to is the pet store owner. And so if the pet store owner recommends a cloth muzzle for non-grooming purposes, or recommends a prong collar over, you know, a no-pull harness, that's the first interaction they get. And so it's that whole idea of continuum of care, where, you know, it's something that's big in health circles, you know, where people come together, they're helping an individual with all these different areas of expertise, various focuses in their educations, but they're all on the same page and have the same goals in mind for the client. And we're not there yet with the pet industry, but it would be a wonderful goal to think about, is this continuum of care from the pet store owner all the way up to the vet and the vet behaviorist. You know, is that this knowledge and these best practices that really set the humans and the dog up for success.
Definitely, and I think when Nikki was talking about the summit, she said that they had a bit of a problem getting sponsors and vendors, because a lot of the companies are not force free, which, yeah, you know, is a sad state of affairs. And I do think it is something, you're right, that most pet dog owners, the first place they go and where they take advice is from the pet store. So
don't get me wrong, we had people that said, well, you know, of course we're force free. Well, and then it was an educational process. Well, philosophically you might be, but you're selling prong and shock collars on your website, so we can't partner with you. Well, and I think there's, you know, obviously everybody has their own line that they feel comfortable stepping behind, but some people just didn't see that as being force. They saw being force, you know, smacking a dog or fighting a dog or whatever. So, you know, everybody has their own definition of what does force free actually mean, which is why when we started PPG, it was really important that we could actually put that definition in writing. And there are still many gray areas. I mean, we still get ethics complaints and someone says, well, what about blah, blah, blah. And, you know, in our guiding principles have our non-negotiables that are absolutely non-negotiable. And then there are gray areas. You know, some people will say using a halter or a gentle leader is forceful. You know, but the argument is that any piece of equipment in the hands of the wrong person can be forceful. So there's also still a lot of gray areas to the definition, and, you know, how large that gray area is depends. But you're absolutely right. You know, those pet store owners, I mean, they really often are. And that's why I think we get so upset by the big conglomerates, don't we? Because we go in there and see all this equipment. And I mean, how easy would it be to really start having a massive impact if some of these large pet stores just stepped up and said, yeah, you know, we're not going to sell this stuff anymore.
Right.
But then it becomes too much about the big green dirty dollar, doesn't it? And unfortunately, whether we like it or not, a lot of things boil down to money and profit.
Yeah, that is unfortunate, but it's true. Yeah.
Yeah.
A lot of the time, it's nothing to do with what they think or what they believe. It's just down to what they think will sell and what will make them the money. Yeah.
And the bottom line is that we're not going to change that anytime soon. So we have to change it from the client's perspective, so that clients go into these stores educated, so that they are either purposely looking for the right equipment, or if someone offers them advice, they go, I'm not so sure because I've read or I'd heard or I'd been told, you know, different. So that's why I think with PPG in particular, and with all our individual roles, we have to be targeting clients, so that clients are better educated, therefore make better decisions on behalf of their pets.
That's right. I tell you what, education is the key, whether we're talking about force-free training, about breed-specific legislation, whether we're talking about muzzles. Education every time is the key, and it's getting the knowledge out there.
Yeah.
So that people can make the right choices.
Yeah, and it got, you know, we can do a full circle. We can go way back to the discussion with Nancy about when you visit a client, you know, sometimes they just want that sentence. They're not in a place. It's not the right time. It's not the right anything to know more. So, you know, we just have to keep educating. And those that we hit with a sentence now, we get with a paragraph next month and maybe an academic paper next year, so to speak, so that we just keep that message going and we just keep it upbeat, we keep it positive, we talk about what we should be doing, not bashing what we shouldn't be doing, And, you know, it'll come. And I mean, I'm seeing it already. I mean, just look at the membership numbers of PPG. I think we are, I don't think we've reached a tipping point yet, but I don't believe we're that far off either. We just have to keep doing what we're doing. And that's, you know, with anything that you feel strongly about that you want to advocate for.
Yeah, that's right. Absolutely right. And coming back to you, Maureen, again, I was going to ask you why you started the Muzzle Up Project, but can you first of all tell me, what is the Muzzle Up Project?
So the Muzzle Up Project is essentially, it's a website and it's a Facebook community, and it's to more, but it started out as a place for education and reliable resources on muzzle training, erasing muzzle stigma, and also proper muzzle equipment. And that's how it started, and then it kept evolving because some things happened, like when I was updating the website and I was searching the internet for resources, and at one point I googled muzzles and muzzle training, and then all I got was hits back to the Muzzle Up Project, and I go, oh dear, so I have to create my own resources. And so it really became apparent to me that there was a need for this kind of thing to be out there. That, I mean, there were snippets from here and there, but there wasn't a concentrated place on the internet where people could access all this information. And then it's evolved into, so muzzle art is one of the big things that's featured on the Facebook page. Is this idea of you know, erasing stigma by decorating muzzles and making them appear less scary. Unfortunately, a lot of the muzzle companies have very limited colors, usually black and beige, which, you know, they look a little scary when they're on dogs, and so, and people have, they really impressed me with their crafting skills, you know, been decorating muzzles, and it's the visual difference between a muzzle that's been decorated with, you know, pink or, you know, decorated tape versus a black plastic muzzle is incredible. So there's that type of thing, and then it's also evolved now to where, as it's an extension of my business, I offer solely muzzle training support via Skype for people who need help working through a muzzle training plan. And so this is, when I mentioned how it's evolved, is I realized that for a lot of people, you know, they're told that they need to muzzle train their dog, or they're ordered if they're in a breed-specific legislation affected area, that they need to muzzle train their dog, and they're kind of given a muzzle and a paper muzzle training plan, and it's overwhelming. And muzzle training isn't easy because you're implementing classical conditioning and operant conditioning, and you're having to work with this piece of equipment. And the kind of cruel irony of a lot of dogs that need to be muzzle trained is that they're also hesitant about having stuff placed on them and being handled, which is probably one of they need to wear a muzzle. And so it's actually quite a big challenge. And what happens is a dog's welfare can be affected by either stigma. So the lack of motivation to muzzle train due to the negative stigma attached to it, or misinformation that it's cruel to the dog, or that the dog will have restricted freedom or not be able to have a good quality of life while wearing a muzzle. And then there's also the lack of muzzle training because an owner just gets stuck for very understandable reasons, because it's overwhelming. And it's, you know, there's a lot of places within a muzzle training plan where you have to split, and where the dog can get stuck. And so that has become a component of the Muzzle Up Project as well. And then starting in starting in 2016, I'm going to do, again, it's kind of touching on this theme of continuum of care, the Veterinary Partners Program, which is an effort to bring in veterinary clinics. They subscribe to this program, and then they get quarterly staff trainings on muzzle and husbandry-related topics. And it can be done via webinar, so it doesn't just have to be clinics where I'm located in San Francisco. And then they also get additional resources that they can give their clients, so that if the veterinarian sees a dog and says, okay, we'd like you to muzzle train your dog before your dog comes back again because we'd like to perform this procedure without anesthesia or what have you, that they can do more than just send their client home with a piece of paper, that they have some additional support. And so it's working in tandem together to really help the client and the dog. And so that's a very babbly, long-winded answer, but that's essentially what the project is. So it's education, erasing stigma, and the training and partnering with veterinary clinics, kind of the four elements.
I think that's a great answer, and your partnership with the veterinary clinics is absolutely fantastic. What I will say, I don't know whether you're further ahead in the States than here, but certainly here, nobody would even be handing out a paper plan to muzzle train your dog. Most people wouldn't even think of muzzle training their dog. They would just get the muzzle and stick it on the dog.
Well, and an interesting side story, it's one of those things where sometimes it's nice to just exist in the bubble. The Muzzle Up Project Facebook page is
ignorance
wonderful.
Is bliss. Ignorance is bliss sometimes.
I know. I'm supported, and the members on that page are so lovely. It's just kind of fun to exist in that bubble. But then, of course, when I went to do a seminar at a wonderful rescue in Idaho, they actually got quite horrible negative feedback when they were promoting the upcoming seminar. People saying on the Facebook posting, how dare you put a muzzle on a dog, it's cruel, and the shelter, the person who managed the Facebook page did a brilliant job of educating and kind of turning those conversations around in a positive way, so kudos to them. But it was like, okay, got to step out of the bubble and realize that we have a long ways to go. And I try as much as I can to kind of stay away from the forums and the threads, because it gets so depressing, and you can really end up just tearing your hair out. But it's true. But one thing that's interesting is I've noticed a majority of the supporters on the Facebook page for the Muzzle Up Project are from the UK and from BSL affected areas, and whether that's because they have to wear a muzzle, so some of them are like, we have to do this, so might as well make this a positive thing. But it's across the board, we got a lot of work to do.
We sure do.
Yeah, definitely. Like I can say from personal experience on my little Staffordshire Bull Terrier Jambo, he's got his own Facebook page, and when I put pictures on there, photos up of him wearing the muzzle, put it this way, I've had to take some of the comments down because they have been, so bad. There weren't comments that I could actually leave up.
Circling back to the breed-specific legislation, we even had, when we were promoting the seminar, it just happened. So if we posted photos of dogs and muzzles that remotely resembled a pit bull, then there was negative feedback. So then, okay, well, let's try. Here's a photo of a border collie in a muzzle. But no matter what breed we posted, how dare you put a muzzle on that breed of dog? So it was whichever breed we put up, the people who were fans of that breed, not everybody, but certain people took offense.
I have a solution to all these problems. I think we just start teaching people how to think critically, and then a lot of these problems will go away.
Critical thinking is key. But one of the things that people really have enjoyed and kind of taken to, and this is, I never thought I would say this, but the muzzle training sessions that I do have ended up being some of the most heartwarming and fun sessions that I've had with clients, and I never thought I would say that. And the reason is because one of the main things that I incorporate into the program and what people will post on the Facebook page, which is fun to watch, is incorporating games and play And so a lot of the stigma is people thinking, you know, that your image of a dog in a muzzle is probably shut down, body language, stiff, because when a dog puts a muzzle on, that once the dog is wearing, necessarily mean that the dog is comfortable running and playing and walking and turning and moving their head. A lot of dogs end up looking very much like robot dogs because it's awkward. They have this thing on their nose. And so what we do is we incorporate games and play. You know, muzzle fetch is absolutely possible with the right kind of toy, muzzle soccer, getting dogs to be able to do their agility and tricks in their muzzles. And it's really fun and it's heartwarming because that it bleeds into, especially for clients, it bleeds into all other areas of training where they really start having fun with their dog because, you know, yes, they're doing it for the muzzle training, but they're doing classical conditioning, doing operant conditioning, and they're rewarding their dog. And it's, you know, it starts to bleed over into other interactions they have with their dog because they're becoming really good trainers. And it's that, I think, as education and also the visual of seeing dogs playing fetch, having fun, and being normal dogs in muzzles is a big key to erasing stigma. The visuals really stick with people. And so it's wonderful that the content that supporters have posted on the Facebook page. I'm so thankful because they're, you know, it's so much fun to see. It's just really heartwarming.
Yeah, that is very true, actually. I did a video a while back about the same subject, muzzle training a dog, and I also wrote an article for Barks from the Guild magazine, and this all came about because of the negative comments that I received about Jambo wearing his muzzle. And what I will say is one big thing that I said in the video is have fun. Let's play some games. You know, it's
fun.
Yeah, it should be fun. If your dog's got to wear a muzzle for whatever reason, you know, it needs to be fun. And we don't want dogs with their heads down on the floor trying to get their muzzles off, and there's absolutely no reason for it. If you muzzle train the dog, there's no reason for it at all. But this stigma that's associated with dogs wearing muzzles, how effective do you think that, for example, the Muzzle Up Project has been at educating the public, not only about dog behavior and safety, but actually erasing the stigma of the muzzles?
Well, I tend to be a pessimist, so I would say that there's still a lot of work to do. But I have received a nice amount of support from individuals and also I guess very behavior aware vet clinics and kind of training organizations. I think where the goal, where we need to take it is in areas that, you know, aren't so tapped into dog behavior, you know. So it's one thing to have, you know, organizations like the Pet Professional Guild or very Sophia Yin type vet practices support the Muzzle Up Project, and it's wonderful, and we need to have more of that. But then, of course, the next challenge is really getting into organizations that maybe aren't so even receptive to force-free training. So again, it's a journey. It's little by little. But then I do have to say, I'm rambling a bit here, but it is nice. When searching for muzzles, the Muzzle Up Project comes up first in a majority of my Google searches, which is both good and bad, because I want there to be other resources out there. But I know that it is becoming a nice little hub for good information.
Most definitely, and kudos to you as well for starting the project and getting the information out there. We've touched on a couple of reasons why dogs might have to wear muzzles. We mentioned perhaps at the vets they may have to wear a muzzle. We've mentioned breed-specific legislation. You've touched on behavior. What other reasons are there that dogs might have to wear a muzzle?
So I don't start with with bite history first. And that's not, I mean, that's a very obvious reason why dogs wear a muzzle, but I think that's part of the stigma. And I think people think that a dog is wearing a muzzle because it's aggressive and it has bitten people in the past. And while that can be a case, there's so many other reasons. So again, one, a big one is the veterinary clinic. So if a dog is muzzle trained, in addition to working, it's not just the muzzle, but again, in addition to working on husbandry procedures and desensitizing the dog to, you know, being handled and being at the vet, it can reduce appointment times, and it can also obviously reduce stress. And you know, when you're worried about getting bit, you're probably not thinking too clearly. I know I wouldn't be, but it can also give the vet an opportunity to do a lot more procedures without anesthesia, which is great, and of course we want more of that. And then another big one is in emergencies. So even, as we all know, even a dog that has never had a bite history or shown aggression toward people or its humans is in pain, or isn't feeling well, or is injured, it very well may bite, and that's just natural. It's a dog's natural, you know, behavior when it feels threatened and in pain. And so it helps avoid trigger stacking, because if you have a stressed dog and an injury, and then you try and put a muzzle on the dog and the dog isn't used to that, well, now you're adding more stress, and you're just stacking another trigger on top of an already bad situation. And so if you're able to, you know, have a nice padding and a muzzle-trained dog, can really help in emergencies. And the other reasons are they go beyond safety. And so one of the things that I've noticed with clients who muzzle-train their dogs is that there's an improvement in body handling, because a lot of the exercises that I'll do with clients, even before putting the muzzle on, are a lot of desensitization to being touched and handled around the head, and which is usually one of the reasons why a lot of dogs need to wear muzzles, especially at the vet, is because they're sensitive, they're not comfortable with that. And so, you know, Pavlov is always hovering on your shoulder, and so it's again, it's a way to help desensitize the dog, and you know, the other nice thing is it helps the dog realize, again, it's reinforcing to the dog that you're safe. Even though I'm putting this thing on you, you're safe. And it builds a lot of trust between the owner and the dog. So even if the dog doesn't need to be muzzle trained, you know, I have some clients who just wanted to do it for emergencies, and also just to have another activity that they could do with their dog, and to just have that in their behavior arsenal, so to speak. And then, of course, you know, dogs with bite histories. So, and what I always like to, we're very kind of reactive as a society, and so, you know, kind of wait for the bomb to go off and then kind of scramble to pick up the pieces. And so for a dog with any type of aggression or reactivity, or a dog that perhaps does have a bite history, giving the dog an option of a muzzle, it's not a free-for-all. It doesn't mean that no other training or management needs to occur, but it can greatly increase a dog's chances of not getting a rap sheet, which is very important, especially when dealing with vicious dog units in the law enforcement department. But it also gives the dog freedom that he may not have had otherwise. So a lot of people will say that they also feel less reactive and more comfortable when they have a well muzzle trained dog, because they know that you know, if something happens, that they're being a responsible dog owner, and that the chances of their dog inflicting a bite are drastically near zero, almost reduced. And so, of course, that's important as well. But I always like to start off with reasons that aren't simply related to a dog's bite history, because I think that's important for reducing stigma, because you know, bites are just they're a big and they're important safety feature, but they're just one of many, many reasons and benefits to muzzle training your dog.
That's so true, and I actually think that every dog should be muzzle trained, because
yeah,
whether you think that your dog needs a muzzle or not, at some point.
Oh, I'm sorry, I interrupted you, but I had a great conversation just kind of on that with a veterinarian who's he's implementing a fear-free program at his veterinary practice, which is wonderful. But we were talking about the benefits of, you know, we think about this socialization window that puppies have, and we expose them to all these different things, you know, brooms and harnesses and collars and leashes and various, you know, handling things and going to the vet and dropping cookies. But muzzles pretty rarely, almost never, are included in that socialization period. And, to be, you know, he was even saying, you know, what do you think about, you know, in puppy classes, just having some muzzles on hand? You know, you don't have to worry about putting it on the puppy when they're little. You can worry about that later. But just doing some basic desensitization where muzzles equal good stuff in that socialization window. And, of course, you have the stigma where people might balk at first if you bring a bucket of muzzles out when you're in a puppy class. But if we can get people to that point, how wonderful would that be? Because, again, it's just it's preventing future suffering for the client and the dog. It's prevention. And I thought it was a really great conversation, and it was an exciting idea to think about. So anyway, sorry to interrupt, but yeah.
It's actually a great idea, a great idea. Well, I'm going to ask you one last question because we are now seriously over time. But I'd like to ask you very quickly, you're at the PPG Force-Free Summit. You're giving a presentation. Can you tell us just a little bit about your presentation, please?
Well, it's going to be on Friday the 13th, so be prepared for potential disasters. No, if you're superstitious. I keep joking about that with people. But it's going to be focused on a lot on the training aspects and working through the muzzle training plan, but going beyond the basics. So we're going to be looking at some case studies of dogs that are not that unusual when it comes to muzzle training, who have some fear issues, and we encountered some sticky, tricky spots in the training process. And so we go through how to create splits in the plan, how to work through difficult things like getting the straps on the dog, and really kind of getting into the nitty-gritty of what an effective and really kind of high-quality muzzle training program would look like. And then we're also going to talk about how to get clients on board. And it'll touch a bit on the motivational interviewing webinar that I did for you guys. Gosh, maybe it's probably over a year ago. But it'll touch on, when I say motivational interviewing, I'm referring to a specific counseling practice that's actually been applied to more than just psychotherapy interventions, but smoking cessation programs, law enforcement. It's been hospitals use it now to reduce risk behaviors in patients with heart disease. And what it is it's a way to motivate clients to change and to do things that they may be resistant to, and muzzle training usually fits into that category. So it'll be not just about training the dog, but also how to get clients on board. And so we'll be talking about just lots of different techniques when you encounter resistance with the client, or when you encounter some misinformation, how to work with that and roll with that, so that you create a stronger relationship with your client and you keep building on trust, so that it doesn't become either a deal breaker or you have fewer breakdowns in the client-trainer relationship if you do have to bring up the topic of muzzle training. So those are the two main themes. So it'll be a lot of fun. I'm really looking forward to it. And so I'm happy just to be able to go to the summit. It'll be lots of fun.
Awesome. And I'm absolutely looking forward to your presentation. Thank you so much for joining us. Can you tell us how people can contact you, the Muzzle Up Project, how they can learn more?
If you're interested in checking out more, you can go to the muzzleupproject.com. My personal website and my training business is called Mud About Town. So if you go to mudabouttown.com, you can see my email and you can get in touch with me. And then, of course, come and say hello at the summit on Friday the 13th.
I am not superstitious and nothing will go wrong. So thank you, Maureen. There's lots of really great information there. So thank you so much for sharing all of that.
Yeah, thank you so much.
You're very welcome. You're very welcome. So I think that brings us to the close of October, our PPG World Service for October. So a huge thank you to Maureen, Caitlin, and Nancy for joining us. We appreciate you taking time out of your Sunday, which is probably normally your R&R day. So big kudos to that. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. Thank you to my cohort over there in Spain, Louise, who, as usual, did a fantastic job with all her questions and keeping the flow going. We apologize for running over, but that's just what happens when you chat, chuckle, and share with friends. So I'm not sure if we will ever hit the nail on the head. But so I'm going to say a goodbye from me, and Louise can say a goodbye from her.
It's a goodbye from me, too. Thank you, Nikki.
Thank you, guys. Have a wonderful rest of your Sunday, and we look forward to seeing you the first Sunday of every month at 12 noon Eastern.